Thank you, Gordon, for joining me on my In the Green Room show and coming back for round two from the Big Phat Band that we had.
Thank you. I hope I don't tell some of the same stories. I'll probably tell them completely different, with like different characters, different conclusions.
Oh, well, that's okay. So the first thing let's talk about is what's going on with you right now and your radio show. And do you still do a podcast, or do you have any new music coming out? What can people look for right now?
Yeah. Well, you know, one of the things that we've been doing in the last year, in absence of any gigs,
right,
and absence of any real projects, we just couldn't do what we had planned, not only with the Big Phat Band, but for the rest of my career too, the more commercial aspects, it all got wiped away. So I found myself, for the first time since maybe college or right after college, where I didn't have anything to do every day. And so I can remember as a kid out of college, I would have a gig on the weekend or two gigs, you know, and playing a wedding reception or something. And then I started to work at Disneyland, and I'd work there in bands on the weekend. But the rest of the weekdays, I could get up, go to the pool, lay around, I could practice, I could write, do a little writing, do whatever I wanted. And I remember at that time thinking, don't blow it, man. You better build something here. I remember thinking that I was in my 20s. So all of a sudden, here I am now, all these years later, kind of in the same situation where I could come down to my studio here. What do I feel like writing today? So I wrote pieces that I normally wouldn't have time to do. I wrote a fanfare for and variations for brass and percussion. We're about to record that, probably remotely still. I wrote a string quartet. I wrote a bunch of Phat Band charts that I wrote a new feature. Actually, the trombones don't know about this yet, but it's a new feature for our trombone section. And the Phat Band did record three songs remotely. And that was a new way of doing it. And it was a challenge to make those songs recorded with each guy in his home studio sound as if we were all at Capitol Records like we normally would do. But I had time to think about just music and not about commerce as much. Now, that worked for about 4 months. And then about month five, then I started to go, well, how long can I go without making money?
Yeah.
You know, and so you could start to feel that pressure a little bit. All the same, I did try to use the time to build for when we open up. Mm. One of the things that I did, and this is interesting because it's not a jazz project. I became aware, before we went on the air tonight, you and I were talking about sometimes you get excited, your adrenaline will inform your body about how you look at something, especially about how you speak. And I have a tendency to speak a little quickly.
Yeah, me too.
I have a tendency, even when I'm on the bandstand, I'm excited and I'll count the tune off a little too fast because it feels right to me at that tempo. But the truth is my metabolism is spinning because I'm excited or maybe nervous.
Can I ask a band leader question? I want to interject this. Can I ask a band leader question about that?
Yeah.
Does the band get to know that you do that and play the right tempo anyway, or do they follow you implicitly?
I talk to my drummer, you know, and I would say, now when I'm on stage, sometimes my count offs will be like this. 1, 2, I'm on 2, 3. And because in a way, the first bar of the count off is almost heads up everybody. And the second bar is the real tempo, because what I don't like on stage is any kind of a stage wait. If you go to see a pop show, you don't see a band leader counting off a band. You see them start the music kind of transitions from. So I don't really want to spend time up there doing that. So I kind of rush through the first bar. Nonetheless, I'll tell my drummer, if I count it off wrong, you know where it goes. Put it there.
Right.
So that's an understanding that we would have. But over the years, I started to think about what's informing me in terms of my choice of tempos And why do I speak a little bit quickly sometimes? And I started to think about breath and breathing and being conscious of my breathing. And that got me into, you know, doing a little bit of yoga, you know, a little bit of quasi meditation stuff. And I started to see the value it had in my life to slow my metabolism down and engage with the world with a little less anxiety. And so as I considered this over the years, I was talking to Vanji and also Kevin Axt, our bass player. We started talking about that. And we had the idea to produce music that could engage that state. Now, meditative music typically is designed to be kind of bland, because you don't want it to be too engaging, because you want your mind to just release and not think. So that, so consequently, that music can be, for me, I'll be listening to, oh man, I hate this. Who could write this? You know, I would start to judge. Like if you're getting a massage, so they turn on that music and I'm getting more tense as the music. Right? So we thought, what if we produced some music that relaxed you, but also had content, that also had structural and compositional integrity that was in alignment?
Well, that makes me think about.
Yeah.
When I listen to music, because I'm a musician, I can't help but pay attention. Mm-hmm. So if you write something that will grab your attention, I mean, even you as a composer now, would you start listening to it as a listener rather than relaxing you? I mean, I'm trying to.
Every time. So, yeah. But not all, some music will have that effect, like Debussy has that effect. I can listen to it and analyze the chords, but then after about a minute, I just get swept up in it because it's perfect. Mm. You know, everything about it is just in alignment and has like a balance. It's almost like a law of the universe or physics, something about it is mathematically right. So we thought, what if we designed music that would be adhere to those qualities, but also enable you to unwind from a stressful day? And so we started to put this together. So I've been composing this music, and we're kind of still putting together how we release it, what platforms, and our company's called Chill. And so we have, you know, we have the different categories of chill, you know, chill tropics, to give you that tropical thing, chill grief, chill joy, all the different range of human emotions. So we've been working on that. And that's been an interesting thing. It's not really jazzy, because I don't want those sharp angles, you know. So I want it to be, if you wanted to listen to this, you go, oh my God, that's a beautiful song, you know. So that's been an interesting project that we've been working on for the past months. Otherwise, we've been starting to book gigs for 22. Not yet for this year. Although we had an inquiry from Moscow, Russia, and I may be going back to Helsinki to do like a music camp. Kind of waiting to see if COVID protocols are kind of allow us to do it, you know. So. But it's been a creative time for me. We recorded a song for Sammy Nestico. We recorded one of his charts, his very last chart, which was called Cell Talk, his last chart he wrote before he passed. We recorded that, and then we recorded a chart that I wrote for Sammy last fall when I knew he was ill, called My Man Sam. So we recorded those two songs, and what we decided to do in the honor of this great man after his passing is we're going to record two or three more Sammy charts and release an EP dedicated to Sammy. It'll have, you know, Cell Talk and the new chart that I wrote, and then maybe go back to the Queen Bee, some of the early bassy Sammy charts, and just give the Phat Band's tribute to him. The fact that we were friends with him and that he had an affection for our band and for me is something I can't overstate what that means to me, because this is the man that started me writing music. I heard music in seventh grade and go, that's it, that's what I got to do.
I remember hearing you say that, and I want to kind of tie that all into your writing. And something that we didn't talk about a lot with the guys is where you were before you started the Phat Band, and guys like me were buying your charts. Mm-hmm. And what were you doing all that time with all your writing and doing the big band thing? And before you started writing big band charts?
Well, I was writing big band charts all the way from, you know, high school, college, and maybe 10 or 15 years after that. But then I started to get an understanding of the economic reality of that music and how the payoff for it was elusive. Also, I didn't have the confidence to know that I could call musicians and get them to show up and play my stuff. Not until I was 40 years old that I finally said, you know what? This is where I live. This is why I started writing music, was because of Count Basie. What am I going to do? How am I going to ever plant my flag? So finally, at 40 years old, I started to focus on it a little bit more. But in the years prior to that, I was involved in writing animation music and film music and working a lot of gigs as a sax player and a piano player. And the writing was kind of just tangential to the playing. But I started to realize that there were a lot of good saxophone players better than me, more committed than me. A lot of good piano players better than me, more committed than me. And maybe I should let them do that. And I can do the thing that I don't see a lot of people doing, which is composing music, especially, you know, big band music. So, but that was an epiphany that took 25 years to get to. Mm.
You know. Well, one thing that I remember the last time we talked about maybe a little bit about going to Tower Records and going through things. And I remember that. But when I became a band leader and a big band, I started one in 92. I started going to Byron Hoyt Music in San Francisco, and I would go through and look for charts. And I was looking for charts. Sammy Nestico charts were great because a band could play them and almost always make them sound good. Yeah. And the audience would be able to listen no matter who they were and tap their feet. And when I started finding your charts, they did the same thing. They were reasonably easy to play. I mean, not too complex.
Some of them.
I mean, well, yeah, you know, some of them, but I would try to find those charts that were, you could keep time. It wouldn't get too out for some of the people, you know. Of course, jazzers really like to hear it go out, but the average listener really likes just to hear some swing stuff.
Yeah.
And I remember going through and picking out those charts, and I had a couple of yours. So is that something you thought about when you were writing all that kind of stuff?
I will say this. I have a reputation of being a hard writer. Hard is a term that I don't like. And if I have anything to say about it, like when the Phat Band's doing clinics with kids, I ask the guys not to use that term. This is hard. This chart is hard. This passage is hard. Because I believe that it predetermines the outcome. Any experience, oh my God, this is going to be hard. You know, I think that I'd rather use the term challenging, because you can meet a challenge. It's a difficult habit to break, because I sometimes will slip and use the word hard too. I don't ever, never ever intentionally wrote, except for one time for Eddie Daniels. I wanted to make it challenging for him. I wrote a piece called Under the Wire for him. Of course, he sight read it, so it really wasn't that difficult. But the main thing for me is I really wanted it. I really respected melody and groove, those two things. So if the harmonies are kind of wacky, you know, or the rhythms are kind of, you know, complicated, the groove never swayed and the melodies were always, you know, hooky. At least some of it was. So I think if you have a melody that adheres to, I think it's the same thing like we said a minute ago, the melody that adheres to the laws of mathematics and physics as pertains to music, it feels right to our bodies. So that's been a goal of mine, is to kind of, and it's kind of integrated into my process now. I just hear that kind of stuff. However, having said that, we have a chart that we just recorded over COVID called The Reset. And we'll be releasing that coming up here this year. And there's not a lot of melody to it as you would just normally describe it. It's got a lot of groove and it's got a lot of kind of samples and loops and different things, you know, a lot of intensity, kind of Frank Zappa-esque, you know, kind of crazy. Mm. But that was a deliberate attempt to try to create something interesting without some of my usual stuff.
Well, in terms of hard, when I think in terms of hard, I think you said it right. Melody and groove stay fairly consistent. And that's what I was thinking when I want people, the audience, to engage in with what the band is playing. And generally speaking, if they can tap their feet and sing along with the melody, mm-hmm. but you could probably do a lot of different things with voicings and everything.
Yeah.
And then in terms of hard, with the guys that you have, it's kind of like this guy.
There it is. If you had Wayne Bergeron, what would you write?
Yeah.
It drives me crazy because those guys kill. They sight read it pretty perfectly most times. And I think, and I'm going to say something here that won't be popular in the town that I live in, but I think that there is maybe an aesthetic that is kind of locked in here in Los Angeles. I've noticed it. The generation of musicians before me did it. The generation, my generation, tends to do it. And they talk about, yeah, man, that was hard. Oh, no, let me put it this way. They value music because in a recording studio environment, the sooner they play it, the sooner it's done and move on to the next one. And then they're off to the next session. So if they've got a piece of music that requires some assembly and some concentration, and it uses the whole session to do it, then it is not as fiscally rewarding as if they go in and knock it out in an hour, then they get out and go to their next session. It's a cynical evaluation because not all musicians have that, but it is there a little bit. And I felt that resentment from guys as a young composer. And there are many famous guys like Sammy or Henry Mancini. Henry Mancini would talk about the value of having your music so it could be sight read first time.
Really?
And if you're writing for a movie, yeah, you better make it so it's pretty playable the first time. But if you're writing music about what you believe in, if you're releasing a record, it just needs to be what you believe in, whether it's hard or difficult or easy or however you want to describe it. So I think music's worth a little bit of sweat.
Mm.
And let me just say at this point, the guys you see on stage in my band have all sacrificed financially up there. Most of the time, they could be somewhere else making way more money. That is the biggest challenge I have in doing gigs, is because I'm not competing with other big bands because we pay, you know, equivalent or a little more probably. What I'm competing with is the Oscars, you know, or a 6-month run of The Lion King, or a Phil Collins tour, or a Chick Corea tour. So I got like a little 3 or 4 gig tour in the middle of June. And Eric goes, well, I'm going out with Chick for, you know, for 4 months. Right. I got to say goodbye to Eric, right? I mean, what am I going to say? But on the other hand, every one of those guys comes when it's at all possible. And Wayne in particular, if he just can break even or not lose that much money, he'll be there because he knows without Wayne, the Phat Band does not sound right. It does. Well,
he really is one of a kind guy.
Yeah.
And, you know, we can say a lot about how people play and can play high notes, but then each of those people also bring a personality.
Yeah.
And something to the music other than just playing the notes right.
You know? His inherent just musicality is true.
Right.
And watching him, I know we talked about this last time, watching him go through the, you know, the throat cancer thing and having to kind of rebuild, you know, his face after that. We had a talk when he was shortly after he stopped his therapy. And I said, you know, you might not be the same player. You might not get it done in the same way, but your musicality hasn't gone anywhere. And so that's what's valuable about you. And so if you decide that you want to play differently and you're not going to be the guy you were, who was just a physical specimen I've seen him. I saw him do it so many times. He would transcend. He had his appendix out.
I remember.
Maybe a week later, playing this Horn Appuente chart that I wrote for him, pounding out these high notes. He sat on a stool. He didn't stand up, you know, a week later. And so, you know, he was a powerful guy, big barrel chested guy, you know. You could take a breath, you could watch his shoulders in the back just fill with air, you know. And that he could rely on that to dig down when he needed a little extra. Now he's lost. I mean, he was 220 pounds, and now he weighs the same as me. He's 185, something like that.
Man, yeah. That's a big weight loss.
Now he's not recommending the cancer diet, but
right.
he's exercising. You know, he's got such a healthy lifestyle now. Yeah. You know, and we love him so much. We're really proud of him of how he, you know, in the middle of that pandemic, attacked that problem and got through it.
Right. The pandemic hasn't made anything easier.
Yeah.
You know, and even except for you having some chance to write and do that sort of thing. But I wanted, here's another thing that sort of come up for me when I was looking at what you've done is conducting, because you were talking about counting off, but now conducting is a whole different thing. Mm-hmm. You've done a lot of conducting for movie scores.
I studied it in college. I wouldn't have chosen to study it, but then I did. Well, the first conducting teacher I had made me. I'm a left-handed guy, and he wanted me to use my right hand. And I said, I that feels so. I can't do it. He goes, well, that's you have the concertmaster's down here. He wants to see the baton up here. That's just the way it is. I go, I can't. So I switched classes to the other guy. The other guy, he's. And I go, can I conduct left-handed? He goes. He goes, you can conduct with your dick if you want. I said, well, hopefully it won't come to that, you know. So he let me conduct with my left hand. And then after that class, I studied conducting with a guy named Gary Pratt, who's a bass player. He was at Northridge when I was. And, man, we picked Beethoven's First Symphony. And my whole first two or three lessons, I didn't get past four bars with him on Beethoven's First. He really knew what he was talking about in terms of conducting and technical things. So it came in really handy for me when it came to standing in front of an orchestra, which is also one of those things you can't practice, because you can conduct to records, but the records aren't really following you. And it's more than just beating time. It's standing up on the podium and getting 60 to 100 people to do what you want them to do. And there's no way to practice it until you stand up there and look at everybody and take their fire. And when I was young, man, the first real orchestra I conducted was the Atlanta Symphony. And those people, they were looking at me like, oh, we're going to eat this kid up. And I had to stand there and push back at them and say, here's my downbeat. Because I remember we had a thing where in those days, which would have been like, you know, the early 90s, orchestras would play delay. Like if you're giving this downbeat like this, bing, right? The sound would be bing.
Oh.
I say, you guys, I need it to go 3-4, ding. Okay, here we go. 3-4, ding. I said, let me say it one more time. 3-4. When I get down here, I need to hear sound. Can you do that? And the concertmaster is not looking at me. I said, look, because I was conducting for Johnny Mathis. He needs that downbeat. If you don't play that downbeat, he's not going to look at you. He's going to look at me. Now, I need you to go 3-4, bing. So I had to get that specific with them. And it was kind of a habit that orchestras have of playing a little bit. They play together, but perfectly behind the beat. So I learned a lot of things from experiences like that. And nowadays, a lot of times with films, we conduct to a click track. So you're kind of a traffic cop, you're queuing entrances, and you're kind of giving the energy of the cue more than conveying tempo, because they're hearing a click in their headset. But I still get to conduct orchestras, well, before COVID, you know.
Right.
Do that. And there's nothing like it. When you get them on your side, all those people, so you're making music and the music is being born right then. There's nothing like it. There's nothing like it in the world. And so I would love to do more of that. I mean, I love the big band idiom, but I adore orchestras. And right now I've written a concerto for trombone and orchestra, one for soprano sax. I wrote a piece for James Morrison, Possibilities for Trumpet and Orchestra. And I wrote a double concerto for piano and clarinet for the Cape Cod Symphony. All those pieces, I've had one performance of each piece. Yeah. Only one. And these pieces take 6 months to write. But when you're there, and I remember every minute of every performance. It was so unique and special, and it's kind of like watching your one of your kids being born, right? You get one shot at that too, but you never forget it. You're so attentive and soaking up every moment. So, we're used to, the environment I'm in, we're used to recording everything and preserving everything and capturing it and archiving it. And some moments, maybe, we don't have to archive them.
When you do those special performances with those different places, has anyone ever approached you to record them with them and that sort of thing?
Yes, but it's cost too much. Mm. It costs too much freaking money. 100 people in the orchestra. You got to get paid, scale. And who's going to buy it? Who's going to buy my trumpet concerto with freaking James Morrison, as great as he is? And it's a really great piece. It costs $75,000 or something to pay the orchestra and then to mix it and then market it and go out there and sell 5,000 copies. And I don't know, it's a marketing puzzle. Same one the big band era, genre has.
Right.
Even worse with orchestras. But I do have live recordings of most of those pieces that we did just off the board. I have to sign a thing saying I won't even put it on Facebook. So it's really frustrating. It's very frustrating not to be able to share the music with the world, but the musicians unions, they have a point of view. They're there to protect the musicians. And while I feel that there's a difference between me and a big network, CBS, there's a big difference between, the resources we have and the intentions we have, but the union looks at it as a slippery slope. If we make an exception for you, we have to make exception for everybody. So that's a big problem, and it remains a problem for those of us that want to try to record our music. I mean, I'm looking at my wall here. I see all the Phat Band records. You can't see it here. I've kind of gone in front.
There's 10 of them?
10 of them. Now, yeah. One of them made us money back.
Well, so, I wanted to ask you about that. When I first started my big band, I tried to do a recording in 1992 and got it released. Do you remember Seabreeze Records?
I do, of course.
Danny Beer?
Yeah.
And he took it and released it. And it was up to me to try to get it in stores.
Promote it, yeah. Oh, yeah, distribute it, yeah.
Right, so I called Best Buy Music when they were first, way back when, and I asked him if they could put it in their stores, and he said, okay, we have got 20 feet of music. We have 4 feet of it jazz,
yeah,
and one fraction of it is maybe big band, which might have Count Basie. Where am I going to put yours?
Yep, I've definitely had that conversation many times.
Right. So how is it, because I admire you being able to keep big band music and your big band, and particularly these guys in the music. And you just said you've not made your money back. So most of the time, anybody who likes big band does it because they like big band, and it's just a labor of love, and there's no real money in it, generally speaking.
That's definitely the case. But for me, since I was working on films and other projects, I work a lot for the Walt Disney Company and those budgets are pretty good. So I can make enough money to support my big band habit.
It's a habit.
That's pretty much been how I've solved the puzzle. Mm-hmm. A lot of other people will, like Maria Schneider, you know, with her, crowdsourcing thing. A lot of people have been able to do that. And that's a nice business model, because that enables the fans, the people that really love it, to say, well, if I love this, maybe I can throw in $500, you know, or something, you know. But that's been harder, since people are used to just not paying anything for music. I'll go on Spotify or I'll go on YouTube. I can hear whatever I want. So I guess I've been on the alert for what is the new paradigm. The Gordian Knot, our last record, we pressed a CDs, we pressed an LP, we did a flash drive version, little 2 gig flash drive, and we did a Blu-ray. Almost every format we released that record on, because there are buyers that like all those formats, and yet it was very expensive. I mean, right over here in my garage, I got boxes of Blu-rays of that record. So, and then of course, you know, we put it on Spotify, we put it on Apple Music, and we put it on Amazon Music. So I think you have to do all that stuff. It's on YouTube. Every track for free on YouTube. And believe me, I love YouTube. I don't like the tiny royalty checks I get, but I use it a lot for my radio show. If I'm trying to hear, let me see, what was that Dexter Gordon song? There it is. Oh yeah, it's 6 minutes long, and I'll kind of scan through it. Oh, perfect. And I can, it's a great resource for me to use to put my show together. And but it's a double-edged sword, you know, because basically, the people that run those sites are utilizing, you know, the creative intellectual property of these artists, and you know, and for very little return. But what other choice do we have right now? Some people keep their music off of YouTube. And I think that they, I don't know if they still do this, but back in the day, they'd leave the link up. And then when you try to play it, you'd get a little message. Sorry, this track not available due to a copyright claim from Gordon Goodwin. And they'll put a little sad face. So anyway, it's kind of like playing whack-a-mole, you know, trying to get your music off those sites. So I just kind of, I've left it up myself.
Mm. You know, I wanted to ask you also about the whole Disney era or the time you worked at Disneyland and behind the scenes things you did. Were you doing writing and things for a lot of Disney stuff?
Yeah. Well, I started off just as a musician. I played piano I play piano in ragtime bands and then in rock and roll bands in Tomorrowland, and then in show bands on these different stages. And then I started to play saxophone. I played in the Disneyland band a little bit. I wasn't a regular, but I subbed a lot. That's where Eric Marienthal and Sal Lozano were in the band then. So we got to be good friends at that point. And I did that from probably 1979 through about the mid 80s. And in the early 80s, they asked me to write music for a Mouseketeer reunion show, right? So this were the original Mouseketeers, along with the newer ones. So we had, you know, Lonnie and Tommy and Sharon and, you know, Cubby, you know, those people from the 50s. But also then this was right before Britney Spears and Christina Aguilera were Mouseketeers. But some of those talented young kids. So I wrote the music for this show that was five times a day at Disneyland. And I learned a real lesson from that, because at the time, my inclination was to write music that the musicians would like, because that's what I started to do when I was in college, high school and college, because I knew I needed the guys in the band to want to play my charts. So I would make it sure. I can make sure they're going to like it. So I'd write stuff that I thought they would like, right? That's how I did it. So I was always looking to put the cool, you know, substitute chord here and a cool counter melody here. So I'm writing these arrangements for these Mouseketeers. And that stuff didn't really belong in those arrangements. And they should have been a little more commercially based. And I'm I remember standing at the side of the stage before a show, and the head of entertainment was around the corner, and he was talking to somebody about me. And I go, is he talking about me? And he goes, I heard him say, well, Gordon Goodwin, that guy's got no commercial sense at all. And I went, what did he say? I have no commercial sense? And I'm like, screw you, man. You know, what do you? And so I started to think about it. And over the years, I realized he was talking about all the altered chords and little doodads I was putting in those arrangements for my own entertainment and for the entertainment of the guys in the band. That's not the gig. So I learned a lesson that I can know all that stuff, but I need to be categorical in terms of my assignment. Right now I'm doing a Christmas record for a TV star. I can't say who it is, but they want Sinatra, Nelson, Riddle. That's the vibe they want. So I have to be careful not to go very Thad Jones in that, right? I need to keep it, what would Nelson Riddle write? So it informs the content that I put in. And the first time I had an idea that was important was for that Musketeer show at Disneyland. Anyway, as I learned the lesson, then I started to do a lot of other shows for them, like parades and firework shows and, you know, dark rides. And it was great. I love Disneyland, man. I always loved it as a kid. And I really love the legacy of that company in terms of its musical heritage. And so to be a small link in that chain has been a great thing. And I'm still fortunately working for those guys. And it's one of the few areas in the music business that hasn't gotten its ass kicked. Well, in the last year it has, but the budgets I get for those projects are pretty close to what they were 10 years ago, 15 years ago. Whereas budgets for TV, budgets for film, you know, so that's an interesting thing. So, I mean, I can go to London at Abbey Road and conduct a 100-piece orchestra and use the best musicians in the world for those projects because they got the budget, because they know this music's going to, you know, run at the Disney parks. I mean, I did a Lion King show in Animal Kingdom. And when did we do that? 98? Still running.
Wow. It's
popular shows. And so this music reaches millions and millions and millions of people. So I think their awareness of that informs, okay, we can spend a little money, make sure it's like as good as it can be, you know, when the terms of the production of the soundtracks.
Well, that is one thing that I have noticed about Disney, because I'm a fan of Disney too. And the main reason I'm a fan is because I love entertainment and I love quality production. And everything about Disneyland and all of the productions they do, the quality, they spare no expense. It's the best you can get. And the fireworks shows, some of those fireworks shows, the music behind them, oh my God.
Well, they have a new model that they're doing now. And I did a show for last Halloween. Well, let's see, it would have been 2 years ago Halloween before COVID in Florida. And they, I don't know if you've seen it, where they have a technology that can project animation on to the surface of the castle. So the show we did was a Nightmare Before Christmas, you know, show thing. And they had fireworks going off, but they had animation going on the castle, and it was just amazing. And they had a big Jack Skellington puppet. He was huge, you know, 15 feet tall or something. An incredible piece of art and technology. And so the music has to be able to support all of that scale. The castle in Florida is huge, way bigger than the Disneyland castle, you know, so they've got plenty of, you know, surface area to do all the animation and the effects and stuff. So we went back there to see the show after we did it. And it was really amazing, really fantastic.
Did they animate before the music and then you scored to the music and put hits at different movements and stuff?
Actually, they animated to my demos.
Oh.
So I would meet with the director and the writer, and the producer, and we would talk about, okay, what the song had to do or what the underscore between songs needed to do. And then I would compose everything and produce a demo of it, a mock-up using my samples and stuff. And it's, you know, it's not final product, but it's fine. You can tell, oh, yeah, that's strings and that's this. You can get the vibe, you can get the emotion. And once that's bought off on, we give it to the animators, and then they use that to animate to. And then we go and record the real musicians and replace those tracks. So, yeah, it's, you know, it's a wonderful thing. I, by the way, I'm totally violating terms of my contract by even saying that I work on this.
Really?
Your contract is, you sign, says you will not imply any endorsement of the Walt Disney Company for what you do.
Well, you're not necessarily endorsing them.
Well, I can't imply that they're endorsing me. You notice that they don't run credits.
Never
work on their shows. And that's a little bit maybe of a throwback that Walt was kind of like, all right, let's just do a one thing. Walt Disney is our brand. Yeah. So the first guy to step back was Roy Disney, his brother. And then all the different animators. And I read a story about an animator. His name was Seamus Cole Hain. And he worked for a lot of studios back in the 30s. But he worked at Disney. He worked on Pinocchio. And you have to have, I think it was 100 feet of animation to get a credit on screen. And he did like, according to him in one of his books, he did like 99 feet. And they wouldn't give him the credit. He was so furious, you know. Anyway, so they just want it to be, it's Disney. That's what it is. And they feel like to spend marketing money to say, well, who directed the show or wrote it or did the music is not of value to them. So
it's getting better. It's getting better on some of the newer movies, some of the Pixar things. You're seeing people's names and that sort of thing.
In the films, yes. In the films, for sure. In the theme park arena, it's a little different in terms of. I always said that to them. How come you don't have programs for your, you know, had a little souvenir program for your shows? Because there are people that go to those shows again and again. Like we would see the same people every day sometimes, you know, and so, but they didn't see the value of that either.
I bought for my children a theme park CD. Of all of the music.
Yeah.
And we loved the music. And I always wanted to know who was playing on those songs, who recorded all those. And more than likely, you and, you know, a number of guys that we've mentioned were playing on those.
Yeah. I mean, most of us in the Phat Band have a pretty rich heritage with that company. And of course, people like Wayne and Andy and Eric and Sal and, you know, all of them are in the upper 10% of what they do, you know, so they're going to get that call. You know, to play on, you know, if you want the best guys, and you know, those are the guys you call.
Right.
I remember back when I was working in film, and we had I was working for a composer named Trevor Rabin, who was a guitar player, and he played in the rock and roll band Yes, and he got a film scoring career, and he was an A-list composer, and I was his main orchestrator and conductor, and I would kind of work with him. And at the time, the contractor would use a particular trombone section because John Williams used that trombone section. So, okay, really, they're great players. But I remember Trevor wrote this music. It was kind of like Hans Zimmer in that it was kind of rhythmic bass with guitars and rhythm section and synths and stuff and orchestral. So if you've got the guitars that are going, you needed the strings to go, be precise like that, right? And so the strings had learned to do that over the years, as opposed to these guys, 3-4, boom, you know, they had learned to play in time with a click and with the track. This brass section, and I remember Trevor had written these just big accents, so the strings are going, and the brass are going, boom, 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 just accents, you know. So these guys are playing like orchestral trombone guys. So it's like boom, 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 like just big, fat, late notes. And so Trevor's going, what's going on with those guys? I said, guys, can you please shorter and right on the beat? Please don't lay back. You need to be right on the click. Right? Can we try it again? 1, 2, 3, 4, boom, boom. So they were just so used to having a different aesthetic in terms of those kind of accents, a more orchestral aesthetic where the music breathed and allowed that. So I remember talking to the contractor. I said, so here's what I think we need to do. We need jazzers. It isn't about this big round orchestral sound for this music. We need people that can play in time. You need to call Andy Martin and Alex Iles, Bill Reichenbach. I talked about some of the jazz guys. We need people that can really hit that, you know, the second 16th note of the beat. And so they just said, all right, let's give that a try. And of course the jazz guys got in there and just killed it, you know? And so it's interesting to watch the evolution, you know. Now, almost anybody can, that works here in this town can play that kind of syncopation and play it in time and do it that way. So
they've had to learn.
And I think it's that way the whole world, actually. Everybody around the world, orchestral musicians, grew up listening not just to Beethoven, but they also have listened to rock and roll and jazz and metrically precise music and become part of their skill set.
So the last thing that I want to kind of cover and talk about a little bit is the Grammys. And you know, you had a couple of Facebook posts, but you know, here's an interesting concept. A friend of mine was nominated for a jazz vocalist, Kenny Washington, and great singer, singing standards, but you know, that didn't get nominated, didn't win. And all of that sort of music, including big band and everything, is disappearing. And, you know, some of your Facebook posts were about all of that stuff. And yep. Now the interesting thing is if you're a pop music fan and if you like to see Billie Eilish, then it was a show about that. But if music is supposed to be what the Grammys is about, it became more of a video show, MTV thing than just real music to me. And there's, you know, some stuff that is going on. How do you feel about music moving forward through education and the Grammys and some of the things you do with the Big Phat Band and, you know, just music in general? I'm leaving a big opening.
Yeah, well, it's a big topic. And this year we had a lot of discussion about it, but it's not new.
Right.
They've been squeezing the jazz and classical music out of the telecast for years. For a while, they had a director, Ken Ehrlich was his name, and he had the idea of doing these mashups. So he would put Herbie Hancock and Lang Lang and have them play Rhapsody in Blue. So you got a little jazz guy, you got a classical guy, and you got Gershwin, and then there's your jazz classical. Or he'd put Chick Corea with the Foo Fighters, or you know. And so that was, I used to think, well, that's not Chick in his best light, and it's probably not them in their best light either, but better than nothing, you know? So it's been kind of evolving that way for a long time, but the telecast is only a fraction of the Grammy experience. In the afternoon before that starts, they have what they call, I think they call it the Grammy premiere, which is where they hand out 90 some Grammys. The show the other day, a couple weeks ago, they barely handed out 10. So in the afternoon is when they hand out the Grammys for all the jazz categories, the composition, arranging categories, you know, the world music categories, the Latin categories, all that stuff happens. They do a great job. They do it at the Nokia Live Theater. Band on stage, lights. It's a fancy, wonderful show. However, the telecast has led a lot of musicians like that play jazz and orchestral music to go, why should I join this group? This has nothing to do with the musical values that I believe in. So there are a lot of people, most people that I know are not members of the Recording Academy. And as somebody who is heavily involved and I've done a lot of work with them, and I love the people over there, and the people at the Recording Academy care deeply about music. They care deeply about these other categories. However, the TV show CBS gives them a lot of money for that show, and CBS wants the artist that you saw on that. That's what they want. So I may, and I listen, I can't speak for them, but I know the money that they get, they can do Grammy in the schools, which is a initiative they do. They do Grammys on the Hill, where they send people to DC to talk about, the issues facing musicians and music creators. They do a lot of great things.
And
the thing that I brought up about the other day, though, was maybe it's time to have a different ceremony. Maybe we have the pop music ceremony, and then we have a separate one, put it on PBS or A&E or I don't know, and it'll be the jazz, classical, rock and roll, world music, Latin music, Grammys, something else. So because the criteria to judge the performances we saw on that telecast is pretty different than the criteria that's meaningful for us in terms of the music that we create. And it's trying to compare apples to oranges. It just isn't really working anymore. So this is not the first time that idea has come up. And right now, the dust is still kind of settling after that whole experience. For me, and I've won four of them, and I've had 22 nominations, and it's a freaking thrill. It's amazing just to get a nomination, to be a part of it. However, it doesn't mean my music's any better. When I lose, it doesn't mean my music's any worse. Matter of fact, most of the times that I've won have been for things that I didn't particularly think was my best effort, but maybe they had some pre-existing awareness, like the first Incredibles, that thing won. Everyone knew that movie. My arrangement of Rhapsody in Blue won. Everybody knows Rhapsody in Blue. My arrangement of On Green Dolphin Street won. Everybody knows that song. And then the Big Phat Band record, Life in the Bubble, that one. And that one meant something to me because that was just from the ground up, just us. That was an experience I'll never forget. So I really think that I would still encourage everyone to join the Academy, to work with them, to try to move it in the direction that will best suit everybody. And but it's a passionate topic. I prefer to not talk about the gender-related issues, the racial-related issues, or even the morality issues about that song they did that was overly sexualized. I'm fine with it. If that's what you believe, or if that level of sexuality is what represents your thoughts, you should have the right to do it. However, if we're giving an award for the best music, I'm not sure how that enters into it. So
yeah,
those are my feelings about it.
Yeah, I mean, I agree. And at the same time, they can perform their music however they want, like you said.
Yeah. I think we have to allow everyone to write the music that they like. They have to write what's now. Hopefully people are expanding what's in their heart. They're learning, they're growing. We've seen this, right? We've seen people like, I don't know if you like Rod Stewart, but he went from the rock and roll guy to now he's, singing Great American Songbook. Linda Ronstadt, same thing. Rock and roll singer, then she's singing Gilbert and Sullivan, then she's singing, Cole Porter. So we've seen people grow as they go on the journey. And that's the hope. I think that's the hope for all of us when it comes to music or just when it comes to just our experience as human beings.
Yeah.
That we grow, we change, we learn, and we get better at being human.
I'm trying to slow down my thing. I'm coming up with stuff. And my mind went blank. So when you do your radio show, you were talking about earlier of trying to get all the stuff out. Yeah. Has it ever happened to you where you thought you had something and all of a sudden it goes?
Yeah. But I've gotten, maybe my experience as a musician, as an improviser, where I've used to working my way out of a corner and just finding something has worked for me in a live setting. Now I will pre-record my radio show. In that case, I can just stop, go back, punch in, fix it. But with the live shows I've done, there has been times I go, what is that word I'm looking for? What?
I know.
By some word that means, you know, the same thing of the word that I couldn't get to. But I think there's a different energy that kicks in live.
Yeah.
Like this is essentially a live conversation. And I feel like I'm not planning anything I'm saying. And consequently, maybe some of the stuff I've said isn't as elegant or thought through as if I would have taken a minute, but it's real, you know, it's honest.
Well,
that matters.
That's kind of how I've liked to do the interviews that I do. When I listen to other people do interviews, they've got a gimmick or something that they need to do. And okay, we're going to do this. Hey. And I like to have it like we're just sitting before a gig and talking, and I'm just coming up with questions as you talk.
Yeah.
Because that's how, if we were sitting backstage somewhere, that's what we'd be doing before a gig.
Have you ever noticed that there are some people that don't even have that skill set when it comes to conversation? You can tell that they're waiting. They're waiting to say their thing in their head, as opposed to reacting to whatever it was that the other person said. I think we should be teaching that. I think we should find some people, to some of us, it's more intuitive, and maybe to others, it's not. So I think it can be some, that kind of interaction. And really what it is, it's listening. That's the thing about musicians. They learn to listen, especially jazz musicians. You have to listen. That's the most important thing, actually. Yes, if you listen and stop thinking about what do I do, what do I do, what do I do, what do I do, just quiet that voice and listen to what's going on, and what you do will just come to you.
That's what jazz is, just improvising, just making it up as you go, really.
Yeah.
However,
a conversation will be informed if we're talking about world history. My opinion is going to be more informed if I kind of studied it and had experience with it, right? And if I'm improvising over giant steps changes, if I've kind of learned the song and figured it out, then my improvising is going to have more integrity as well, because I've done a little homework. But then after I learn it, then I leave that aside, then I react spontaneously.
Right. So. Well, I've thought that too when I'm talking to people and getting to know a few things about them so I can say some things. And at the same time, the way I like to get to know people is just to sit and ask questions then that lead me to other questions.
Yeah.
Which sometimes is more fun for me because I'm learning and discovering as I go.
Well, do you ever get you know, an interviewee that is unable to have that kind of level of?
Yes.
Short, quick answers, and then just stop talking, and then you have to start it up again, start the momentum up again.
Yes, I have to do that frequently. Well, there's been a few times, but most of the time, musicians like yourself, we're pretty good at about talking about music when we get into those topics, and it flows pretty well. But once in a while, there'll be some guys that just couldn't, you know, like I got Bill Champlin on, and he talked for. You know, I'd ask him a question and he'd have a whole story, and this has been great. I had somebody on once and I'd ask a question and it would be, yeah. And I'm going, boy, I have a new respect for people who do interviews. You know, all those guys, those late night shows.
Yeah. Oh. To look at Johnny Carson and go, well, he really looks like he's interested and engaged and natural and letting it unfold with some degree of spontaneity. But he's got his cards, some questions on there, but they're just kind of a starting place.
Christmas. Exactly. Your Christmas music. So did you had the guys record video and audio in their homes, right?
Well, we did the rhythm section and Vanjie in a studio not far from where we live. And we were all in separate rooms. And we all we had our phones, you know, and on tripods there, and we were able to catch. And then Vanjie, when she wasn't singing, she had her phone and she was getting B-roll. So we had a static phone catch, and then she would go and just get each guy that was soloing. And then Eric Marienthal and Francisco Torres, rather, and Mike Rocha would do their parts at home. So, and then we had Joey De Leon, a percussionist. He came in later and overdubbed his parts in the same room because we had Christmas decorations and stuff. So, and then I did all the editing, put it together, and tried to see when you're shooting video that way, you have to convey the illusion of connection with, you have to move like you would on stage and act like you're engaged with the band and the audience, you know, so it looks right and not just sit there, you know? And right. So there's some tricks that we've kind of picked up to make it look, you know, like a performance.
Are you using Final Cut or just iMovie or what to edit the video?
One of the things I did when COVID started, I decided to learn Adobe Premiere Pro. I just asked around a lot of video editors and several of them said, that's the best program. Cause I had iMovie, but I was thinking, should I upgrade, you know, to the, to a Final Cut or should I just, so I tried Adobe, learned that, got up on the learning curve. And now I'm pretty good at it, actually, not as good as a real guy, but, and, you know, it was, the tricky bit, like, right. Cause with a little Phat Band, we had like 10 people, so I could kind of get those people on screen. But with a Big Phat Band, when you've got 18, then it can be a harder thing to line up and to go. Mm-hmm. So we hire a guy to do that for our videos for that.
But aren't you getting a little, if you're like me and you start doing the video thing, I start getting a little geeky about it. And it's just like now, I'm not really a pro at it, but I'm going, you know, I really want to I'd like to learn and do all that. Do you find yourself going down that rabbit hole a little bit?
So very, very time consuming because, you know, because then once you start to learn, you go, oh yeah, that got to fix that. I got to fix that. Absolutely.
All right. Anyway, so thanks Gordon for being here tonight. I've really enjoyed it and having a conversation with you has been great because it's been easy and fun. And I've learned a lot about you and your band.
Thanks, man. I love talking about this stuff and I have such gratitude, you know, that I've had a life that I've been able to do this stuff. And even though I've been doing it for some decades now, the truth is I still feel like I still kind of figuring it all out. And that I think is a good thing. You know, it's a good thing to have something like that to make yourself get out of bed and keep, you know, plowing ahead. So really appreciate you having me on.
Thanks. And I look forward to seeing all the new stuff come out and you'll be posting things on Facebook, your website and all of the different places.
All the usual places, man. We'll slam it out there.
All right. Great. Thanks, Gordon.
Thanks, Jeff.